Following my recent journey into storage media, I came by this pretty much rundown silicon graphics tape streamer. Besides this squash connector, the main question is, will it still work? And can it actually do more than just backups, like storing digital music? Retrocomputing is the use of older computer hardware and software in modern times. I'm the Vintage Collector, and these are my stories. When I first saw this, I thought this to be a joke. Never in my life is this a silicon graphics tape drive. Someone just glued the SGI logo onto an everyday case. But I hadn't time to deeply investigate it, so I just took it home. In the worst case, I just have an ordinary wannabe SGI tape drive. Though once I started my online investigation, I found some proof that Connor Peripherals once indeed had struck a deal with Silicon Graphics as a supplier for SCSI peripherals. And even so, I found some online sources, including pictures, proving that this unit here actually may be a legit SGI peripheral. At least until I took it apart and found it's actually an HB tape drive inside the HB354080A, which is a DDS1 tape drive. DDS is short for digital data storage. DDS cartridges exist with capacities between 1.3 GB for DDS1 and up to 160 GB uncompressed in the latest DAT 320 iteration. DDS itself was derived from DAT, the digital audio tape. And rumor has it that the tape drives furnished by SGI Systems were actually for storing both digital data and digital audio. But those were different drives, as according to my research, SGI never used HB drives. And we'll learn in a few minutes about the drawbacks for using a so-called foreign tape drive. But here I am with the HB DDS1 drive. Said that, it looks like the original tape drive by Connor was replaced at some point by an HP drive, which again was replaced by another HP drive. But that doesn't explain this squash SCSI connector. Anyway, that's what I'm going to start with, as I need it fixed in order to reconnect the drive. As I have some excess cables around, it's no big deal to create a new cable. Apart from that, it gets a cleaning, plus I have to adapt the pinout for the SCSI selector cable, as obviously these were not connected, but instead jumpers had been manually set. I do get the impression someone just slapped the drive inside. For the reassembly, I also had to give it some thought on the heat shield, as at first it wasn't clear to me how this one fits inside. Eventually, all is cleaned and reassembled again, so I'm ready to give it a try. Hey everyone, big news, our video sponsor PCBWay is hosting their 11th batch design contest and you could be the next winner. If you're into design and creativity, this is your chance to showcase your skills and grab some awesome prizes. Check out the full details and enter today at the link in the description. Don't miss out, this could be your time to shine. As for the SCSI cable, I noticed it's quite too short, but it will serve the purpose for now. First, I want to see if the drive shows up in the PROM monitor. And it does, connected to SCSI bus 1 with ID7. Awesome! Once I'm on the IRIX desktop, the tape drive appears as the cartridge icon. Double-clicking the cartridge icon opens the removable media panel from which I have direct access to the backup and restore functions. So let's try that out. I'll be just doing a quick test to back up my home directory. As suggested, I'll use relative path names. This way, I can choose the destination upon restoring the files. For the latter, I created a directory at /temp/testrest and pointed the restore at it. And voila, here's the restored files. So the tape drive seems to work. Of course, one could do the same using CPIO and TAR from the CLI, but I'm more inclined into investigating the capabilities of this drive. As shown here from the HINV command, the drive appears as unknown. Despite that, it works as a basic tape drive as we have just seen. What doesn't seem to work is the automatic eject, and when reading the man page, it states being suitable only for floppy and CD-ROM media. That's somewhat odd, but anyway. What bothered me more is that the drive is reported as an unknown device, even though it generally seems to work, even with the read-only protection. According to this reading, the drive can be configured by adding it to the SCSI driver definition and rerunning the auto-configuration to rebuild the kernel. Unfortunately, many of the reference sources here have vanished and haven't even been saved by the Internet Archive. But here's another source explaining the detailed procedure for SGI IRIX. As you see, I'm basically cloning an existing block and adapt the descriptors to match. Just be sure to adapt those counters here as well, as these define the character length of the vendor and device strings. Once I shut down the system, I had to quickly turn on the backside of the tape drive and flip those dip switches into the correct position. On the next reboot, the tape drive does no longer appear as cartridge on the desktop, but is referred to as DAT. On the CLI, it as well reports differently than before, as shown by the empty status command. And one major difference is already noticeable here, the eject option in the graphical UI, which is equivalent to running empty unload from the CLI, has become functional. Also, Dotman, IRIX's onboard DAT tape player, now starts and is able to detect if a medium is present. But, even so, I inserted an actual DAT cartridge, it would be unable to recognize it is an audio tape. And that's because the HP35480A can only handle digital data and has no digital audio support. Supposedly, even 30 years ago, some people have asked for DAT audio support for that very same drive, as we see on this very, very old FAQ entry of German IT magazine CT. So Dotman is unable to use this drive for DAT audio recording and playback. In order to do that, one would need to use a drive offering audio functionality like some Sony drives. At least, as far as pure data mode is concerned, nothing has changed and backing up as well as restoring works still the same way as before. So if this endeavor taught me anything, then that I'm now in the need of an audio-capable SGI DAT drive. What do you think about it? Did you use tape drives in general and DAT audio drives in particular on SGI machines, and what was your experience with it? Let me know in the comments below. I'm the Vintage Collector and this was my story for today. Thanks for watching and see you again next Sunday. Next time on the Vintage Collector. Ever since I restored my SGI O2 workstation, I was scouting around for the O2 MooseCam. And once I finally got one, I found I couldn't connect it to the stock AV board. Bah! All these hurdles only to get into Silicon Graphics video conferencing capabilities.